So I figured if we're imagining deep time, why not start at the beginning of time? But is that the beginning of time? What if we go back to physicist Alexander Vilenkin describes the time before the Big Bang as a closed spherical space-time of zero radius. If anybody understands what that means, come find me afterwards. And then I'm sure you're all familiar with the baby picture of the universe. But I'm not here to talk about baby pictures. I'm here to talk about old things. And just right there, I've kind of shown how we are temporal relativists. So what we're looking at here is a tree that was basically inspired my project, The Oldest Living Things in the World. So as many of you might be familiar, the project is about continuously living organisms that are 2,000 years old and older. And since this is a discussion primarily about deep time this evening, I wanted to explain why I selected 2,000 years as my minimum. And it's precisely because I wanted to put into perspective how shallow our human timekeeping is. So right now it's 2014, it was 2004 when I was visiting that tree. But when you think about it, why is it 2014 right now? And of course, we have all sorts of cultural reasons for that. But the idea for this project was to then just indicate a year zero as a starting point and to look back from there. And then there's a whole story that I probably won't get into since we're a little pressed for time, but it is in my book about how I ended up visiting this tree. Although I do want to mention, at the time, my background is as an artist, it's not as a scientist, although I've always been science curious. And I've also, thank you for the person who laughed at that. And I'd also read a lot of philosophy in undergrad, and I was familiar, in fact, with the clock of the long now, the 10,000 year clock. Just at the time, it was still a sketch or a prototype. And these ideas of deep time, it sort of started percolating into my thinking, as did this desire to create a project that combined art and science. So I didn't have an epiphany standing in front of this tree, but over a year later, while describing this really amazing travel adventure I had, all of a sudden, the project just clicked into focus. So this is a map of not all, but many of the locations of the organisms that are found, as you can see, on every continent that are continuously living for 2,000 years or more. So this includes both unitary and clonal organisms, so those that are self-propagating. So many adventures ensued. So this is me at the Niels Bohr Institute, where I was suited up to take a look at the very oldest known living thing on the planet, which is some Siberian actinobacteria that lives in the permafrost. It's between 400,000 and 600,000 years old, living in Siberia. This is obviously imaged under a microscope. And what you're looking at here is a soil sample, because we didn't have access to a scanning electron microscope at the time. I also learned to scuba dive for this project. That was a bit of an adventure for me, since I have a bit of a fear of deep water. I was photographing here. This is a 100,000-year-old seagrass meadow in Spain in the Balearic Islands. So if anybody knows where that is, it's right by Ibiza. If you've been partying there, you were partying next to one of the oldest living things on the planet and probably didn't realize it. In regard to the scuba, though, this is more what my first dive looked like. So that's actually in front of this brain coral, which is a 2,000-year-old brain coral living in Tobago. There's only a very few animals that surpass the 2,000-year mark, but there are some, and that was a huge surprise to me. Sort of had forgotten that coral is an animal. Also, if anybody has a submarine, come see me later, because there's a couple of other corals I need to reach, but they're in really deep water. Thanks. This is up in Greenland, donning the Arctic safety suit. And I was there photographing these rather diminutive lichens. These are called map lichens, or Rhizocarpon geographicum. And this is one of my favorite subjects from the project, because these grow 1 centimeter every 100 years. And that's by far my favorite statistic, because that really puts human lifespans into perspective. I mean, think about it. If you spent your entire life just growing 1 centimeter. Continents are drifting apart faster than these lichens are growing. I had to include this. This is a Eureta plant. There's several of these in the book. They're sort of the poster children of the project, just because they are so incredibly weird looking. So this is in the Atacama Desert in Chile, very high elevation. I think it's around 15,000 feet. It is not moss over rocks. They are shrubs. They are comprised of thousands of branches that are very densely packed together. And at the end of each branch is a little cluster of leaves. And these are related to things like carrots and parsley. Also, parts of the Atacama Desert are known as absolute desert, so there's no recorded rainfall. There's a little bit of rainfall here, but you start looking at these landscapes and your definition of what it means to be alive and what it means to survive definitely have to change and adapt. That's a baby Eureta, by the way, for comparison. So I've also, through the book and through the project, I wanted to include some landscapes. This isn't, there might be some old things in this picture, but science hasn't told us that yet. This photograph is called Medusa Kelp in Hercules Bay. This is made on South Georgia Island, which has nothing to do with the state of Georgia. South Georgia is in the Antarctic convergence, and anybody who knows the Shackleton story will be familiar with it. This is a place where I think geologists would certainly appreciate it. This is one of my favorite places on the planet that I've seen. There's something about some of these landscapes that can just grip you and transport you, sort of like a window into a timescale that none of us could possibly experience except for in the here and now, in a glimpse. This is in Antarctica. This is Elephant Island. So I went to Antarctica to find some 5,500-year-old moss, which is on this hillside here. And this happens to be right around the corner from where the Shackleton expedition was marooned for over a year. And there's a story about how they started smoking the lichens on the island. They were really desperate at this point. They were marooned for, I think, over a year on this island, 2 years in Antarctica altogether. And I was just really thankful that they weren't marooned on this side, because certainly they would have tried to smoke the moss. But you certainly, again, have this appreciation for times, not only for timescales, but for the very human attributes that we give it, for just the perseverance that it takes to live in an environment like this. And I really can't help but continuing to think about Shackleton and his crew marooned in Antarctica for 2 years, and they didn't lose us. Every single one of them survived. Still blows my mind. So we're going to go back to the other side of the world. This is a tree in Sweden. It's on the cover of the book, that is 9,550 years old. This is something that you probably wouldn't guess just by looking at it. Obviously, it's growing, I shouldn't say obviously, it's growing clonally. Get my laser pointer out again. So for the first 9,500 years of its life, you just would have seen this mound of branches here. But what happened is, in the past 50 years or so, you're looking at a portrait of climate change. The climate zone got warmer at the top of this plateau, and so this spindly trunk started to grow. And it's obviously completely changing the structure and strategy that this organism is using to survive. Now, I want to take a step back for a moment also. So obviously, climate and environmental issues run through the heart of the entire project. But I also wanted to just mention, from an artistic standpoint, as I continued to work on this project, I realized that I wanted to differentiate this work from landscape work, per se, and was starting to think of these more as portraits. So I consider this a portrait of this tree. And then you'll also see, obviously, the handwriting. That's my handwriting at the bottom of all of the images. And that's both a nod to scientific field notes, but it's also integrating the title into the work. And they're all built the same way. They have the name of the organism. This is the date date it was photographed, 0909. This is a catalog number for my sake. I shoot hundreds, if not thousands, of images. I would never find them again if they weren't numbered. Then the age and the location. In this case also, the exact location of the tree is kept secret. It's in the Dalarna region, but I promised the scientists who did the research on it that I wouldn't give too much information, although all the locals know where it is. I wanted to include this image. This is this photograph is hanging in the exhibition now. This is you can see that obviously these are some dead trees. This is dead Huon pines that are adjacent to part of a living colony of the Huon pine. The living colonies would be off to the side, where actually where I'm standing, and then sort of arcs around. I didn't get as much access in Tasmania as I'd wanted. In fact, it's the only place in the world where I was blocked from seeing some of my subjects, but that is a whole other story. But one of the things that I wanted to mention about the Huon pine is just to help explain how we know that something like this is 10,500 years old or thereabouts. So at the bottom of the steep hillside where this stand is, there's a lake, and at the bottom of the lake bed, some scientists collected some fossilized pollen, which they radiocarbon dated to 10,500 years, and then did some genetic cross-matching. They did a genetic test of the fossilized pollen and then matched it to the living clone and found that it was an exact match. So that's why we can know that this stand is at least 10,500 years old. It could in fact be much older, and that's why you'll mostly see round numbers and approximate dates for these organisms. Also in Australia, this is a rare eucalyptus that is so rare I can't even tell you the species name, because that will give you too much of a hint as to where it, to where it lives. There's only four or five individuals of this left on the planet. And actually, this one and the last one both happen to live on mining sites. So it's sort of, I don't say it's a mixed blessing, but they were, this one at least was discovered because of the mining on the site. And then you can see a bit of that orange safety fence behind it, protecting it. So I wanted to shift gears again and take you all to my exhibition that just opened in Brooklyn last Saturday. You're welcome to come up there, but in case you can't, I'm going to walk you through it really quickly. So I just wanted, for reference, and we do have one of the photographs here, but you can see that I try to create an experience that will allow you into the work in multiple ways. So one of the things, some of the things that we've talked about here tonight from the other panelists are discussions about layering, and certainly photographic time, photographic layering, and entry points into both deep time and to incorporate personal time into a deeper time experience. So what I've done in this exhibition is combined the photographs with some of my scientific information and research. So if you, the next room, this is the Linnaean taxonomy, where I've selected a few of the photographs to represent the different kingdoms that are that have surpassed the 2,000 year mark. And then I also, for the first time, created basically a research lab / studio in, this is the next room over, to illustrate some of the research that goes into the process. So you don't just have a final finished photograph. There's all these other things that happen. You know, we have, that's my deep timeline in the middle there, that's in the middle of the book. But I have things that I've collected on my travels all over the place. I've got the travel books. I have there's an x-ray on the wall there for the time I fell and broke my wrist in Sri Lanka as part of this project. Sorry, I'm gonna back up for a second. But basically, what I was trying to do was to weave all of these things together and to show that we have all of these layers and layered thinking, because we are transdisciplinary as people. So why would we just look at the photographs or just look at the scientific research? And I think that's one of the values that art can bring and that art and science collaboration can bring, is that when you look at something from outside of your discipline, you're opening a door, window, whatever analogy you want to use, that allows somebody who doesn't necessarily play by the same rote rules that you have to be able to try something different and perhaps expose something that hasn't been done before. So to finish up, I wanted to go back into even deeper, deep time with a few last subjects. These are some Antarctic beaches that, in fact, did used to live in Antarctica 180 million years ago. So these trees are not actually 180 million years old themselves, but rather the species when the south started to grow colder and Gondwana started to break apart. They migrated, and so they now live on the Gold Coast of Australia. And these are growing clonally. You can see they're sort of in that ring shape. They're around 12,000 years old. Another favorite of mine are the stromatolites. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with them, but they're part biologic and part geologic, and are some of the earliest known, if not the earliest, organisms on Earth. And if that wasn't remarkable enough, they perform photosynthesis and are responsible for oxygenating our planet and our atmosphere. So the next time you take a breath, thank a stromatolite. So the other thing that's interesting is just beyond the ridge there is a meteor impact site. And so you can't help but wonder, did they piggyback in from somewhere? And back to our friends, the lichens. Some of these lichens, not this exact one, were sent to outer space by some astrobiologists studying the beginnings of life on Earth. We could do a whole other discussion on extremophiles, but we will not do that now. But these lichens spent 10 days exposed to outer space and returned completely healthy and intact. And again, if that doesn't turn on your head your idea of what it means to be alive, I don't know what will. So this is me photographing a 13,000-year-old shrub oak in Riverside, California. On one side is a cement factory, on another side is a shipping container factory, down the other side are some off-road vehicle tracks, and the scientists said that there was discarded old meth lab materials in the garbage heap. So the layers of time really are coming together here, where you think about at least 13,000 years ago in Southern California, there were mastodons roaming around, saber-toothed tigers, and this shrub was just sprouting. And then here I am, a photographer, in my 30s for a little while longer, standing there making this photograph at a 60th of a second, and we get all of these really fascinating temporal layers all happening at once, but they all had to coincide in that one moment. And I'm going to leave you with an image of, this is the tread of the Mars rover. I didn't go to Mars yet, but this is at JPL in the Mars yard. And what you're looking at there, difference in the tread there, it says JPL in Morse code. It used to actually say JPL and they got in trouble. So at any rate, my next work, I am going to be starting to look at deep time and deep space, and as you could see, some of those organisms were a great launch pad into those realms. And for sure, we have some human perspective to join us. So thank you very much.